that NBC grouping. Right, so there's four things I want to talk about, and it's kind of a very impressionistic view of it, or fairly self-contained thinking, soon after I'm going to be in the field tonight. So, everything to do with the idea of random tomography, that you have four galaxies, so redshift 1, redshift 2, but this case represent the physical of these galaxies, and you measure the random signal on them, and if you can measure them on multiple redshifts then you can prove how the distal system of galaxies in the global structure that's blending them evolves over the redshift range. There's the 0, there's the 0, and there's the 0 to 1 is a very interesting place to prove, because that's where that energy is at the ticket. Okay, so these are the kind of things you can measure. This is a simulated blending shear field, 3 degrees by 3 degrees in the sky, and the galaxy clusters. We can measure shear correlations over the whole field and other many types of fields. Two-point functions, three-point functions, so they carry in this one dimension. You can measure them as a function of split angle. And these two points don't have to be at the same redshift in the sky, as shown in the previous slide. You can have many redshifts in them. So you can measure cross-spectral characteristics. You can measure the mass distribution of clusters, or you can stack clusters or even galaxies and measure the mean mass profiles that are very interesting for many purposes, and I'll show you some results from those. So you can measure various kinds of two-point functions, which are not talking about, I don't know if they're going to come. So there's two redshifts then, you have redshift 1 and redshift 2, you can measure two kinds of angular power spectra, that's the angular wave number L, that shows the coherent shear that structure is imposed on scale, there's one arc in the shear to 1 degree here. So this is decreasing angle, increasing L. And you can also measure the cross spectrum. So there's the shape of the spectrum, not very interesting, and obviously you know the shape doesn't make you laugh. But the antitudes of the spectra, and you can see you have three of them, two redshift bins with five redshift bins you have in the tunnel or so, are very useful. And the relative antitudes do create dark energy, and they do allow you to distinguish the modification of gravity from the atoms. So that may be a most promising avenue for being able to test both choice. Okay, just some usual random formula, deflection angle, the observable convergence and shear, that depends on both the density, that is both the structure and the geometric factor, and, the body line is that you may be able to, so you could construct any part of our engine model or a modification of gravity that fits W, but then wouldn't get the same evolution of structure, and that's how you could get those, the arrows tell you where modifications of gravity and then also these equations, so the deflection angle is right, the gravity equation as well as the Poisson equation, which get modified, and so it's a really interesting game to have particular theory of gravity and work out the consequences of the blending. So cosmological scales, what we're talking about is weakening gravity at late times in large scales, and this leads to modification of the Poisson equation. It's really difficult to construct any generally consistent theory, and that's about a gravitational theory rather than some dark energy model that you can pick up, but it's immediately testable because it has to pass all the system tests and a real test, since you have to work out scales and times. So it's a very much of a system thing to come up with a theory. And here's where it's capital three. Just a few random points on recent development for those of you interested in this stuff. There's a DG3 theory that involves extra dimensions. There's Terrace, which is a consistent formulation of none. And these are the only two that we are talking about. It's not to say that they're very successful. Terrace appears to me with dark energy and dark matter, and these are other problems. Those are very useful theories to look at, and maybe more successful theories will have some of those in our future. So, a question that one can ask is what kinds of models of particular models can do about the blending data currently. And you can look at galaxy cluster and galaxy strong angles, and often some blending information if you like, and the results have shown us some really interesting ways that you can play with even single on them. The other kind of test that I'll talk about a little is a measurement of the blending power spectrum at multiple redshifts, and then it's declined. And so what we really want for this large scale test is to compare a dynamical and kinematic probe. And we know that we have a kinematic probe in supernovae. So the idea would be that a theory like DGP, that matches the supernova data, this one might think of a theory that it has this one parameter, and so once that parameter is chosen to match the supernova data, we have a prediction for the mean mass density and the global structure. It's only in a very asymptotic approximation that this can actually be calculated, so that's another problem, so that's a different problem. But in principle, this has predictions. And on large scale, the growth is still about 3-5% compared to the equivalent dark energy model. The projections that such modifications of gravity that you weaken on large scale to lead to acceleration will not surprisingly have a slow growth of structure. So that's interesting. It means that such as weakening extends down to 100 megaparsec scale or smaller, And we may be able to use the axial switcher for lung manipulation. We do need cordillinear and non-linear connections to have, you know, a few different level accuracy. So to the extent that we can do non-linear calculations of these theories, we can try to come up with these predictions, so this is about simulation, that is simple shows you the tuning power spectrum, the lensing power spectrum, and even though the linear spectra for these different classes of gravity modifications, so the real observable fields here, the non-linear spectra due to most coupling effects is still distinguishable. So we're not going to be detailed, but this is the kind of work that we are pursuing to compute predictions and observable regimes, in this case, what we do. Okay, for a complete change of pace, I'm going to talk about analysis methods in the cleansing. This is the intro, a brief history of the cleansing, the history of the blue, if you see it in red. The points to make about the history are, if you just look at the visibility, so I won't talk about that. But we cleansing blank fields, they were putting in fields, 26 years old, and we have the detection stage and the measurement stage. And in parallel, what's really important is that we have made qualitative advances in how to measure not just the lensing signal, but the systematic bias from the instrument in the end. Prospects are contained in these acronyms, the various surveys that you've heard of, and, you know, between the current ongoing survey and probably over the next 5 years, there's maybe a factor of 10 in size and statistical error, and over the next decade, maybe another factor of 10. So when we talk about advances in analysis, what we're talking about is this pipeline, and this is sort of the schematic version of it. Then you take some image on the sky, you detect stars and galaxies, and then you have to measure the point spread function from the south and interpolate it onto galaxies and decompose it to get the corrected shapes of galaxies. So these three steps are the core of any lensing analysis and where the systematic errors enter and where these instruments, atmosphere, gravitational effects on your telescope, and non-trivially, that our methodology and software have not reached perfection yet, because it is a tricky problem to get the empire to. Once we have these, then measuring the shear correlations and getting them to redshift and getting them to the primary colors. Okay? So I'm going to give you this 5-minute visual example of the kind of things we're trying to improve in these analysis methods. And then I'll show you the real work. This is kind of funny, though, 4 and 5 minutes, 7 minutes. So these are 3 exposures. These exposures for just, obviously, we have seen this before, 9 weeks, a few months ago. And the problem is that these are the shapes of stars, which are not in the lens, by anything cosmic. And these shapes don't work round, because these whiskers represent the electricity of the shape, and the size of these whiskers is about 5%. So this is one of the worst examples in current data. So I picked them to make the point that you have patterns like these, and they may look like these macro galaxy clusters, but they're not. So that's a real problem. So what you do is that if you have a galaxy sitting somewhere there, you can interpolate the shape of the matter from the stars onto the position of the galaxy, and correct for it. The interpolation is going to have errors, because you can see that this is, you know, not a fixed pattern, it's very widely available to you. So there's a new correction scheme that we developed that uses not just the stars in any one exposure, but the stars in this exposure, and this exposure, and this exposure, and the other 1,000 exposures, and does a principal component analysis of them to find the patterns, the principal components of the patterns that produce all these 100 to the effects. And the logic of that is that in a telescope there are, you know, other 10 variables that drive these 1,000 patterns, and the variables come in different combinations, so you think you're looking at a bunch of unrelated patterns, but in fact they are related. In this case, if you look at this one and this one, you see that if you rotate the whiskers, the first order, you can map one to the other. So the trick involves, for the outcome of the trick is that you're able to use all the stars and thereby do a much finer sampling of the PSF to correct the shapes of galaxies. So this appears to work well in current data, these are corrected shapes, and more importantly, the future surveys, you know, the most confident that the correction improves with survey time. So this is a qualitative advance in the sense that as statistical errors go down with increasing survey area, we hope that the correction of systematic errors will go down as well. So it's kind of a wrong statement, but we think we have techniques that can tackle generic GSF and act after the patterns. And there's a great deal of refining that does seem to be done. But at least we have this one set of techniques that should work. So this is an example of systematic error correction. And here's another kind of bold table that summarizes my favorite list of dominant systematic errors, which is with the planet's atrophy produced by the atmosphere. These are things that one can improve by methodology and software. This one requires an external data set, and these are full of theoretical issues. that can, in principle, be sorted out by improved predictions. So these are improvement factors we need for the next generation and the next generation surveys in TA09. A good comment that we expect these are not stable even if we can't see it. This is kind of extra data, and this is the one that is not really understood at the moment, but it's actually a comment. I'm happy to talk about these more if you want.